A lot of my compositions, believe it or not, they never start from a groove. Think of it not as a solo, think of it as a composition. As a drummer, of course, I've stolen from everybody, but as an engineer, I've also stolen. And it's the most wonderful way to learn your craft, because in the end, you make it yours. And actually, the basis of that song was I Am a Walrus by the Beatles. Yeah.
So all of you out there watching, please welcome Simon Phillips to Drumeo. Simon, it's so great to have you here, man.
Great to be here. Great to be somewhere.
Yeah, right?
It's great to be anywhere, actually.
Exactly. I was just thinking over the last week, Simon's been here for, I guess, the last 5 days. And I feel like I've taken a trip through like rock and roll history. The amount of stories that we have heard that you're all going to get to hear, some of them in this lesson here, but in all the content we filmed is pretty amazing. So it's been an absolute treat to have you here.
It's an absolute pleasure. Lovely. Really fantastic place, fantastic environment, and people are okay too.
Oh, well,
no,
at least
great.
We passed.
Absolutely wonderful. We've had a good time, had a great time. Yeah,
I love it. So, to any of you who aren't familiar with Simon Phillips, I hope most of you are because you've played on everything, on so much music,
a few records. Yeah.
So, first of all, we're going to get into a track called "I Will Remember."
Uh-huh.
So, why don't you tell us a little bit about that legendary track?
This was, it appeared on a record we made in 1995. It was actually my first record with Toto. I joined in, end of 92, but technically 93. I had set up a studio for Mike Porcaro in his next door neighbor's backyard. And there was this little hut that was a kind of a little demo studio, ADAP machines. And that's where we did all of the demos for the Toto record. Toto are not very keen on doing demos because what ends up happening is that the demo seems to be better than the real track, which happens a lot in recording. So my advice is play really badly on demos. So it's unusable. Or record them really badly with lots of like mains hum going through. So there's absolutely no way they can be used. Because I didn't know this, I was asked, there were a couple of demos that I recorded, thinking they were demos, which were bounced onto the master machine and used. And I go, oh, wow, had I known. But anyway, Luke came around and he said, I got a new song. And he started playing it and I thought, wow, this is really cool. And I said to him, I'd like to approach this in a more Peter Gabriel way. So no cymbals, just all toms. Now I had a little drum kit there. I think it had 5 tom-toms. And we laid a demo and I did something. I don't know how close it really is to the record because I couldn't remember it. That's the thing. We did that and song was ready. And he said, fine, an hour, that's it. And he was off. We come to record this track, and I guess I'd left the demo at home, or maybe I never even did a mix of it and put it onto 2-track, and I couldn't remember how to play it. Now, for everybody else, it's pretty straightforward. I mean, just play the chords, you know? But for the drum part, it's actually quite intricate. And I was messing around with all these different things, but I knew something wasn't right. Just as we started rolling for maybe the second take or something, the door of Capitol Studio A opens up, and it's Vinnie Colaiuta, and he comes in. He realizes they're recording, so he closes the door, and poor guy has to stand there for the whole take. Now, the take I'm playing is not the take we ended up with. It was, I don't know what I was doing. It was just one of those scenarios where I just couldn't remember what we did on the demo. Anyway, we finish the take, and Vinny comes in, he says, hey, Simon, you got a pair of brushes I can borrow? Oh, yeah, here you are. Gave him a pair of brushes. He was doing a session next door and probably forgot his brushes, you know. So, and the door closed, and we, I think we had a listen, and Paige said, that doesn't sound right. And I said, no, you're right, it doesn't sound right, does it? And eventually I went, oh, okay, hang on a minute. And I went out, and I figured it out, and I remembered, thankfully, what it was. Didn't have to drive back to the valley, you know, find the demo.
Yeah.
And that's the story behind I Will Remember. I think it was done in the next take, take 3 or take 4, something like that. Yeah.
Very cool. Well, this is this is Toto's I Will Remember.
All right, here we go.
everyone. So before we carry on, I just want to give you the chance to check out Simon's brand new course inside of Drumeo called Elevate Your Drum Sound, where he talks about how and why he sets up his drums the way he does. He gives you some studio secrets and tips and tricks that he's been using for years about four on the floor playing, about how he plays the toms and a whole bunch of other stuff, and really just how to approach the drum set like an engineer. And I know many of you know that Simon is an incredible audio engineer, and it really comes through in the way that he plays his drums and even just being around him in the studio, the way he sets everything up, it really comes through in the way that he actually plays the instrument. So if you want to check that out, you can click the link right below this video and you can get a 7-day trial to Drumeo, and I hope to see you inside.
That's such a, I mean, it's a beautiful song.
Yeah.
But just the dynamic contrast between all the parts that you're playing around the toms. I know you've even talked a bit about how you play the kick drum in this. And there's so many intricacies and delicate pieces to this groove.
Yeah.
You want to talk a little bit about that and kind of break this down?
Sure, yeah. So, well, the basic groove is based around quarter notes on the kick drum. But you could play it a different way. You could play it like this. No, that's not the way it goes. The kick drum, even though it's playing fours, it's only the first beat that is, let's say, mezzo forte. The rest of the beats are just. And that way, it doesn't interfere with the toms. If you play a part like this on just tom-toms, well, there's no cymbals. There's not a lot of top end. So you don't want to mud it all up with more bottom end. So you have to be very aware of that when you're playing. And also very aware of, you know, I only use the gong drum very lightly, every two bars. And also, I don't change. If I were to keep changing the tonality, the listener would be brought to the drums, and therefore the song would suffer. It's not how it goes, not for a song like this. The drum part has to be almost hypnotic. So you don't really notice it in the end, you're just listening to the song. And actually that's the best production, really, I think. You know, you always play for the music. So yeah, you have to play that. And you can see I'm not playing loud at all. Yeah. I mean, it's a ballad. Mm-hmm. And the other thing, especially live, in a big room, big auditorium with a huge PA, if I start playing these toms loud, I mean, you know, it'd be like, you know, Metallica versus Toto, you know? So, no, you have to be very careful about what you choose to play. And also, my toms are, I mean, they're wide open.
Yeah.
They're ringing, you know? So you have to learn how to control that ring. It just so happens to be that's the sound I like. So that's the basic idea behind the groove. Yeah.
Do you want to talk a little bit about, I mean, everyone's asking about your setup. You want to talk a little bit about why you have so many toms? Yep. I know this cymbal right here has a pretty cool story.
Yeah, that's got some history.
Yeah.
Right. Well, I've used this particular version of the setup for quite a few years, probably since 2012. I moved these floor toms and put them up here, and then added this little popcorn snare. This was always here. The concept, my concept about drum kit was when I was a child, my mom was always on at me about not getting round-shouldered. There were many drummers, Buddy Rich, Chick Webb. These drummers had been playing a long time and they had got very round-shouldered. Gene Krupa, he was kind of, you know, when he played, I mean, when he stood up, he was fine.
Yeah.
And my mom was on me like, you know, I mean, it was amazing, you know? So I was always very conscious about keeping my back straight and playing. But one of the issues was playing cross-handed. I feel it now if I do that. I can feel the tension in my back. So one thing was to switch and learn to play open-handed. But the other thing was the bass drum. When you set up with a single bass drum, if the bass drum's facing the audience, you're actually facing there. You know? And if you're twisting yourself, you know, things are not going to work out so well. So that was one of my main things to playing, apart from wanting to play two bass drums, I realized that sitting in the middle of the kit like this was actually much more healthy. And I'm now, you know, 65. I've been playing a double bass drum kit since 1974.
Yeah.
And I'm in pretty good shape, back-wise. Yeah. You know, I mean, we all suffer a little bit sometimes, but most of the time, I have no back problems. And I think a lot of that has to do with, for most of my career, I've been sitting behind a double kit.
Gotcha.
Isn't that weird? Yeah. So anyway, back to the drum kit. As he's sitting there, you know, going, well, what about me? You know, you're talking about you all the time. What about me? I'm the one that, you know. So anyway, we have two bass drums, Edwin, Arthur, 24 by 15. We have Roger up here, 10. Alex, 12. Clive, 13. No, I'm not going to continue with these.
I mean, I could. You committed to it, so.
I kind of committed to it, didn't I? Yeah, yeah. Benedict, the 14.
Oh, man.
Oh, boy. Tristram, the 15th. The 15th? Tristram, the 15th? He must have been like, you know, must have been killed by a longbow and an arrow or something
in the
13th century. Right, and 16 by 14, he doesn't get any name. 16 by 13 and an 18 by 14, gonguhu. In Japan at Tama, they call it gonguhu drum with a timpani head on it. I have a 10-inch popcorn snare drum, a 14-inch by 6.5, that's my new 30th anniversary, or was it 40th? No, if it's Tama, it'll be 40th, I think. And a 12-inch piccolo and a set of octobans. That is an A. That is a B. This is a C sharp. Almost. And this is a D. That's A440, though. All you guys in Europe, these are all flat. And then cymbals. We'll get to that in a minute. We'll go from this side. This is a 17-inch crash, almond. This is a 18-inch crash, almond. That's a 19-inch crash, almond. This is a 24 Oriental trash, which has a 14-inch trash former inside. It sounds just like a dustbin lid. Perfect.
Just what you want.
Just what you want. It's about the same price as 1,000 dustbins. But there you go. This is a 12-inch splash. This is a 22-inch ride. Not that heavy, actually. All these cymbals are pretty light. You can see they're all bendy. I love that. And one of my tests of a good crash cymbal is to use your finger. Now, a lot of crash cymbals, you do that and you break your finger.
Yeah.
And it sounds like that, you know. 14-inch hi-hats, and then we get to the piece de resistance. This is a 24-inch swish knocker made in 1979.
Wow.
Now, this one has a history, but I have two more, which I found in the Zildjian, not their vault, but the Zildjian cymbal selection area or room. There was a guy there called Leon who was helping me pick out my first endorsement cymbals in 1979. And I looked down, I said, what is that? Is it looked like a swish, but it looked big. And he pulled it out and I went, ah. You know, it was like the golden arc, or, you know, yeah. So, and of course I use it as a ride cymbal and I love it. It's just, check this out. And I was in rehearsals with a band, an interesting band, with Joe Walsh, Skunk Baxter, and Keith Emerson, and John Entwistle, and Rick Livingston. And this guy walks in, he's a drummer, and he comes up to the drum kit. I'm just kind of having a cup of tea or something, you know. Oh, yeah, a little bit of tea. Having a cup of tea, you know. And he comes up, he says, "Hey, Simon." And I go, "Hello." And he goes, "My name's Eric Singer." "Oh, hello." And he was clutching this cymbal, and he says, "Look, I know that you use these big swish knockers. I will never use this. Here you are."
Wow.
Isn't that lovely?
Eric Singer.
So, Eric, thank you very much, and I've taken good care of it. Yeah, very special symbol, awesome.
Well, that leads us perfectly into our next part, which is a drum solo. I think this is what I'm most excited for, to just watch you play this kit.
All right, yes, yeah. Well.
And I see what happens, I guess.
Oh, it's always like that with me. I never know. Never know what's going on. Let's see what we have.
Let's do it.
Okay. Thank you.
done, man. Wow. Yeah, like for me, the thing that stood out the most, obviously the whole thing is incredible, but your use of dynamics in that is, like, as an audience member, as someone listening to that, I'm immediately pulled in. When you start to dip in volume and you start to dip in intensity and stuff like that. So what's your kind of thought process behind putting those ideas together and creating something like that?
Oh, it's an old trick.
Take note. It's an old trick.
You know, drum solos. There are times when I hate doing them. I don't want to play them. Then there's other times where I really enjoy playing them. What it is, I think, okay, so for a lot of young drummers, when you start playing a solo, or start soloing, let's say, you have a limited toolbox because you've only been playing for, you know, 20 years. No, I mean 5 years. You know. Actually, even after 20 years, you still have a limited toolbox, believe it or not.
Huh? I'm not even there yet.
It takes a while, you know. Right. It's a life investment, you know. So what we tend to think of as a solo, we tend to just play all our clever licks. And if you listen to a young drummer, you know, unless he's absolutely gifted, I mean, you know, like a Tony Williams or something, it's really a collection of everything he can play. And he can fit that into one solo because he really only has a limited toolbox. Then the more you play, the more stuff you learn and the more type of music you play, you find there's all this stuff that you realize there's no way you could fit it into one solo. You'd be there for a week.
Yeah.
You know? So one good trick I found, and, you know, when I think about drum solos, I don't always listen to drummers. Hmm. I listen to a great horn player, great piano player. And I try to, even though, you know, this is there's an atonal instrument, and depending on how you tune it, and the amazing thing about a drum kit, there's no standard. You know, you have a piano, it's a standard. Mm-hmm. The layout is a 12-note scale, it's standard. The only thing that changes is the tuning, whether it's A440, A441, 42, 43, 40, you know, there's all sorts of different tunings. I've even seen an orchestra at the in L.A., the Disney auditorium there, where Danish composer, very modern music. And I swear he had half the orchestra tuned to 440 and half tuned to like 443 or 44. Because he had two pianos and two harps on each side. And when they played together, it was like, oh, you know? And if you're sensitive to tuning, that like, ooh, ooh, you know, it's a quarter tone almost. Yeah. I look to other instruments for inspiration. And also, one thing I do is limit myself. I forbid myself to play any licks that are fairly easy to do, sound great. No, I try to never resort to anything. And I'll give away a secret, those who've seen me play a few times. If you ever see me do what I did at the end, and I didn't do that for that reason, but the octobarn, digga 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 digga, and the gong drum, you know I'm in trouble. I just can't seem to play very well that day, or I don't think I'm playing that well. So I resort to that, you know, because I know it's an escape route, you know? It's my little fire escape in case of emergency. Break glass, you know. But what I try to do is always play something that I've never played before. Mm. Now, obviously, you know, you repeat yourself a lot, but I limit myself. I may say I'm going to do all double strokes. I'm going to see how long I can do that.
Yeah.
Or I'm going to say I'm not going to touch a cymbal. Maybe I didn't. I don't think I did until like the very end. So those are the parameters I set myself in a solo. And every night, if we're playing every night, I'll go, oh boy, solo next. Here we go. They've been playing the song, and I'm going, now what? You know, I'm literally going, well, what did I do last night? I did, oh, something like that, you know, oh, brushes, you know, or I'll put the snares on and do some snare drum stuff, you know.
Yeah.
I always try to make it interesting for myself as well, and for the band. I don't want them yawning away, you know. Mm-hmm. It's a tough one. But I think if you watch, you know, the great drummers, there's a channel there. They're channeling whatever it is, and you'll see there's a thread going through the solo. And you just got to think of it not as a solo, think of it as a composition. That's really what a solo is. The great soloists play little compositions within the composition.
That's great advice. Great advice. Let's move on to another track.
Oh, that soon? Okay.
Yeah.
All right.
I know the hour goes by so quickly, but...
Boy, yes, doesn't it?
The one we're going to do right now is off the new record, I believe, called Unde Viginti. Hopefully I said that right.
Unde Viginti. Unde
Simon Viginti. Does it better than
Hail I do. Hail Caesar. Unde Viginti. It's Latin for 19. So I'll give you the backstory to this song. So 2020, we're all locked up in our homes, you know, yeah. COVID era homes. And I remember precisely how this song came. A lot of my compositions, believe it or not, they never start from a groove. And if they do start from a groove, it's a piano groove. I've sat down and gone, check, do, you know, whatever it is. Yeah. I never sit down on the kit and come up with something and put something to it.
Yeah.
I can't remember the last time I did that. So a lot start off with a melody. And on each album, I do a tricky piece of music in a very odd meter. When I come up with these, though, I never know the meter. It's like when Catalyst, I composed that on a plane, actually on the way from Austria to Japan on a Hiromi tour. And I just got my MacBook out and I just came up with this thing, and actually I ran out of fingers. I wanted to ask my passenger if I could borrow his or her fingers, but I thought that wouldn't be very cool, you know. So I kind of, you know, a bit like a typewriter, you go through 10, then go back to the beginning, you know. I needed 17 fingers, basically.
Yeah.
Could you hold up 7 fingers, please? They would think that was very weird. I mean, thrown off the plane, or captain would come out and put my wrists in a, you know, wrist tie and sit me in front of the plane, looking back at everybody else. So, anyway. Unde Viginti. So I'm boiling some eggs for breakfast, and I'm singing this, what is a little bit like a Bulgarian folk tune. It's not any particular folk tune, it's just in the style of Bulgarian folk music. And I went, ooh, hang on a minute. Switched the eggs off, ran through to my makeshift studio, switched everything on while I'm singing so I don't forget it, because I'm terrible at that, and eventually got Pro Tools launched and everything, and just kind of put a click on that was in 4, actually, and then just started playing, picking up the notes and playing the notes in. And then once I'd got it in, I went, right, what time is this in? And I was going, hang on, and I slow it right down, and I go, oh! Like that, you know, it's 19. So I put 19, tab, 8, and return, you know, bing, suddenly we're 1916. Now, the Pro Tools actually might have been 1988, because obviously it's a sequencer, so it doesn't know any better. It just knows 19, that's it. And that's how this song started.
Very cool.
And then it went through, you know, the usual metamorphosis, and there's sections in 5, and there's a section in 7, and then... So when I sent the demo, I'd made a demo, sent it out to the band, Otmar Ruiz calls me up. He says, hey, Simon. He says, what's the clave? The clave? Because he's from Venezuela, you know, he plays Latin music. He says, yes, if you could give me the clave, I will get this... 19. And I thought about it, and I thought, you know, what a great idea. So I just thought for a second, I went, and I went, this is it, Otmar. It's like an injured bossa nova, basically. You know, there's my clave. Anyway, oh, that's it. Good, fine. Chick. And that was it. Crazy. And that's how he related to this, you know, let's say odd meter.
Yeah.
That's really what it is. So, but again, playing an odd meter, no matter what it is, it's still got a swing. It's still got to have a groove. And that's where I place the importance when I come up with the drum part. I have to figure out how I'm going to play this, you know?
Yeah.
Like now.
Perfect. And it all started with boiling eggs.
With boiling eggs, yeah. Of course, they were hard by the time I got back to them, but there you go. All right, here we go. We'll be right back.
That's crazy.
Yeah.
And you can
four
hear that.
Eggs will do that to you.
Yeah, right? You got to keep cooking eggs. But you can really hear that whole, like the clave in like many different spots in that track.
Oh, yeah.
Mm-hmm. And I know like counting out 19 is often way more difficult than just memorizing that clave.
Exactly, so. Exactly. I mean, the thing to remember about odd meters, there's only two and three.
Yeah.
That's all there is. Because everything is made up of subdivisions of twos and threes.
Yeah.
You know, so this would be 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 3. So it would be 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 2, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, That's like using a slide rule, you know? But if you think of the clave, which is, I'm going to use that term all the time now, you know? It's like I wrote this song years ago. It was on the Symbiosis song, and it was actually a clave in seven.
Okay.
And it was kind of a more of a Latin type song, and I was out on tour with Los Lobotomies at the time. John Pena was the bass player, and I said, "Hey, John, I've got this idea. Does this work? It's basically a cascara, but it's in seven.
Yeah.
And this would be the clave. So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, boom." So it's actually two claves put together. It's like 1, 2, 3, 4.
Yeah.
And then the second half is 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6.
So it's like the 3-2 and the 2-3.
Is exactly.
Yeah.
So I'm just taking out a beat. So. So it makes then a lot more sense. So that's one way of being able to certainly internalize it easier.
Very cool.
More easily.
We're getting close to the end. We have two more tracks that we're going to do.
Wow.
I know it's been an hour already.
Wow. Sorry, crazy. I must have been talking too much.
I'll listen to your stories all day, so it's all good. The next track we're going to do is a Jeff Beck tune off of. There
and back.
Yeah.
There and back.
But the one you're going to do is called The Pump.
The Pump, yep.
So maybe just chat a bit about how you got hooked up with Jeff Beck.
Oh, well, the guy responsible for introducing me to Jeff was his old keyboard player, Max Middleton.
Okay.
I did a few sessions with Max, and Jeff was looking for a new band. This was in 1978. So Max recommended myself and John Giblin. John Giblin, Scottish bass player. He ended up playing Carr is the singer. Oh man, why can't I remember that name? Mel Gaynor. What was the band that Mel Gaynor was in? Mel Gaynor. Quick, look it up. Anyway, so real 80s band, great band actually. So that's how I met Jeff.
Simple Minds?
Simple Minds, thank you. And that was my first meeting with Jeff, and then I was asked back, which was very nice, and then he invited Stanley Clark over and invited me over, and a tour of Japan was planned, and that was the start of it, you know? We had started recording There and Back, but the songs were written by Jan Hammer at the time. And Jan, in fact, came over, so I got to meet Jan as well, a longtime fan. But he needed new music. He needed some more tracks. So by this time, I had introduced Tony Hymas to Jeff. And I said to Tony, I said, let's get together. Let's start writing. And the first track we wrote was a song called The Golden Road, which is on that album. The second track, I don't remember what that was. Might have been El Beco, actually. Then I think the third track was The Pump. It's actually, the original title was The Powers That Be. Okay. Now, I just had a concept of the track. I knew what the groove, this is my very early writing stages, I knew what the groove should be. And actually, the basis of that song was I Am a Walrus by the Beatles. Yeah. And I had a cymbal, and I think I put another cymbal on it and put some gaffer tape on it to make this really cruddy, like that kind of sound.
Yeah.
If I had had that then, I would have loved that. And I just started playing this groove. And Tony just went to B, he'd be boom, 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 like this. And then we just started playing it. And then I came up with a melody. To create a guitar sound, he had an ARP Odyssey, yeah. An ARP Odyssey. I fed it through a little amplifier into a pair of headphones, put a microphone in the headphones and put some gaffer tape around it, and then cranked it so they were distorted. And it was kind of like a guitar sound. I still have the demo.
Really?
Yeah. And Tony's playing the melody, but that's how we came up, you know, with the melody. And then we did the demo on a Revox 2-track,
yeah.
Played it to Jeff, and he loved it.
Crazy.
Yeah. Isn't that lovely? All right, The Pump.
Yeah, let's
do it. Yeah, you ready? Here we go.
Thank you.
There it is. Nice. Nice work.
Live fade.
Such a great, like, simple groove, but it's, yeah. The pocket is so deep.
Now, I have to stress, we didn't cut that with a click, by the way.
Well, it's pretty good.
So there's a, I mean, obviously, you know, it was 1980. I was like 23, and, you know, it was a few little things which I had to kind of, you know, go with. You know, probably play it a little bit differently now, but yeah, it was one of my favorite songs to play every night, actually. You know, to me, because it was so simple. You know, yeah. It was all sound bass. You got that right sound in the right venue. And also playing in a big hall, you know, 10, 15,000 seater, going boom, bop, boom. I mean, it's just wonderful.
Yeah.
You know, and the bass drum too. It's four on the floor, as we like to call it. I don't know why it's called that, but there you go. But the first beat is louder than the second beat, and the third beat is louder than the fourth beat. So whenever I hit a snare drum, the bass drum lightens up just a touch.
Yeah.
And that helps the groove. Doesn't make it sound so mechanical. So that's my little secret to playing that, you know?
The one thing we haven't talked about is you have something in your bass drums.
Oh, I do. Yes, yes, yeah.
Mm. I know we've been posting some clips on social media this week. And yeah, some of you know what's in the bass drum, but Simon, why don't you tell everyone, enlighten all of us.
Well... So throughout my career, I have stolen many things, not just hotel towels, which I think Interpol are still after me, actually, the phantom hotel towel snatcher. Every time I did a clinic, I'd have to, you know, unless I had my own kit, that was fine, but if I was picking up a new kit, I'd have to grab a couple of towels, and sometimes I'd put them up here, and, you know, I'd eaten a really good meal, you know.
It's rock and roll.
Yeah, absolutely, yeah. So... I stole my technique. So as a drummer, of course, I've stolen from everybody. And but as an engineer, I've also stolen. And it's the most wonderful way to learn your craft. Because in the end, you make it yours. But you have to look at other people's ideas and go, wow, never thought of doing that. So when I first worked with Ken Scott, and this is all goes back to my bass drum sound, 1975, I was listening to an album. It was Stanley Clarke's first solo album, which it was done in 74, actually. Tony Williams was the drummer.
Yeah.
I heard that record, and remember at that time I'd done quite a lot of studio work, so I knew what a bass drum and a microphone sounds like when you put those two together. I'm listening to this bass drum sound, I'm going, that mic's inside the bass drum. That's the only way you would make it sound like that, unless it was really close to the front head, or maybe close to the back head, right? It's a very live bass drum. And so for many years, I tried this, and then finally I got to work with Ken Scott. There's a much longer story, I'll keep it short, because there's how Tony dealt with it, and how Stanley dealt with it, and how Ken dealt with it, anyway. So and then I first get to work with Ken on There and Back, and I say, right, Ken, I know you're doing something with your bass drum. What is it? And he says, I'll show you. So we take the front head off. He gets two towels, roll them up, stick them to the batter head. So there's nothing else in the bass drum.
Yeah.
Whereas in those days, you used to have the front head off and put a piano cover in there. I used to have foam in mine, actually. Okay. Thick, you know, like 3-inch or 4-inch foam. And then he put a microphone, an Electro Voice RE20, and he got some mic cable, split it open, and took the smaller cable out of it, twisted it around the mic, and attached it to the screws, the bolts that hold the tension rods on. So it's like this, and there's the mic inside. Mm-hmm. He got the maintenance engineer of Abbey Road, EMI, to put a mic cable through the air hole, just like this, and solder on a female XLR, plugged it into the mic, said, right, put the front head on. And that's the sound that you hear on There and Back. And that's the sound I've used ever since. I've modified it, obviously, you know, but that's what it was. Then later on, I was working with Eddie Kramer, famous for all his Jimi Hendrix recordings. And we were having a little phone call because we were doing a recording for the launch of the Shure KSM-44 when they first came out with their high quality condenser mic, double diaphragm. And he said, so what does your kit consist of? I said, well, I've got two bases, blah, 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 blah. I said, okay, all right, well, the only thing I want to do is I want to put a paint can inside each of your bass drums. And of course, I said, what color? And he said, if I had $100 for every time I was asked that question, I wouldn't be calling you now. I'd be sitting on a beach somewhere. And I said, oh, okay. And I said, Eddie, I've had just about everything in my bass drum except for maybe water and goldfish. So, which I think Keith Moon tried once.
I wouldn't be surprised.
So we got to the session and I took the front heads off and he put a little towel in there. He put a 1 gallon paint can. He actually put a little microphone on it. It's a little Beta 91, which I don't use. And then put the front head on and put the mics on. And I played it and I went, they had a solidness, a thuddiness, which was always missing because of putting that front head on. Because it does cause problems. It's a much more dynamic sound, but without the front head, you can, people that play where they call, it's called burying the beater, and it goes boom, like that. It's easier when there's no front head. Mm. But if you have a front head that's live, like mine, it'll just, my beaters would just bounce. So when I hit the bass drum, straight off it, just like the hands.
Yeah.
Same with the feet, you know. But I knew instantly. I said, "Ooh, that's nice and thuddy. Great." And he said, "Come and have a listen." And we were recording to analog, you know, 2-inch tape, and it was a Neve console. And I had a listen. I went, "Ooh, ooh, that's nice, Eddie. What have you done?" He said, "Nothing." "Really? That's flat, flat." And I went, "Now that's how sound should be. It should sound great before you do anything else to it." Yeah. You know, some people say, well, what kind of plugins are you using? Plugins? In recording? Well, first of all, we can't do that because of the latency, but no, that's the sound of a bass drum going through a microphone, going through a mic pre, hitting, well, used to be hitting tape, now it's hitting a converter, you know? So that's the story of the paint cans anyway.
The Simon Phillips secret to the bass drum sound.
Yep, yep.
That's we've come to the end.
That's it.
That's it. Aww. It's not like you've filmed much while you're here.
No. Oh, it's been a wonderfully enjoyable week. Thank you, and wonderful crew. Absolutely wonderful crew. Thank you, all of you, crew people. I can't mention all your names; it'll take forever. But Josh, thank you. Ross, thank you. Casey, thank you. Brandon, thank you.
Cheers.
And everybody else. Yeah, yeah. Wonderful. Awesome. Yeah.
And like I mentioned at the beginning of this live session, we have a ton of videos coming out from Simon. Some crazy stuff, some incredible courses where you're going to get to learn directly from Simon and get some insight into where your legendary sound comes from. So it's pretty
how
pretty
my
cool.
brain works. Yeah.
And how,
yeah.
how Simon's brain works. So Simon, thank you so much for being here. It's been an absolute
pleasure.
Honor.
Absolute pleasure. Thank you very much.
You're Wonderful. Always welcome back. And I
thank
hope
you.
To have you back
thank
soon.
Thank you. All right.
So we're going to close out with another track from your new record called
yep.
Nyonga.
Nyonga. Yes. Yes. Yeah, you might think this is kind of a strange ending song, but it's not a fast, flashy song. It's a tasty song.
I love it.
So, yeah, yeah.
Awesome.
What can I say about this one? In this composition, I used a bit of a slightly reggae approach in where beat one, I leave out quite a lot. And it's kind of nice. It kind of works. This is almost like try to get away with playing as little as possible. And dynamics, incredibly important on this one. Groove and dynamics, that's really what it's about. But there's some very intricate rhythms in here, you awesome. Know, especially the bass line and the piano solo and the guitar solo. Yep.
Awesome.
Okay, here
well,
we go.
Thanks everyone, and we'll see you all later.
Okay. So why does your sound matter? Music is a big thing, and it's not always just about the playing. It's about musicality. It's not about how fast you can play something. It's how best you can play this piece of music. I think this course is going to point out a few factors which you may have not thought about before. Frankly, it doesn't matter what make of drums you use. It's how you use them. It's what heads you put on them, how you tune them, but more importantly, how you play them. I'm Simon Phillips, and I'm going to help you become a better musician. I'm Simon Phillips, and I'm going to help you. I really am. Yeah.